I used to think life was a game of threads, pulling the right ones, cutting the wrong, weaving success from control. I was Eleanor Whitman, a no-nonsense textile designer, dismissive of anything that couldn't be touched or measured. God, heaven, the sins, those were fairy tales for the weak. Then one day, my car flipped and I died, at least for 7 minutes. In that time, I didn't meet darkness or silence. I met the threads I'd woven, broken, frayed, and stained with the consequences of a life lived selfishly. It changed everything. I was running late again. The irony wasn't lost on me, a woman who built her career designing timeless works of art, always racing against the clock. Deadlines, meetings, clients, they consumed every waking moment, and honestly, I liked it that way. It kept me sharp, focused, and untouchable. There wasn't time for messy emotions or pointless distractions, like my assistant Amanda's endless prattle about her church choir or my sister Cheryl's passive-aggressive guilt trips about family dinners. I was a woman who got things done. But that day, something was different. The tension was already thick as I sat in my car, weaving through traffic with one hand on the wheel and the other clutching my phone. "Cheryl, I told you, I can't make it to Mom's memorial. I have a meeting that could decide the future of my business." My sister's voice crackled with hurt and anger on the other end. "Ellie, it's not about the business. It's about being there for the people who loved her, who love you." I sighed heavily and hung up without saying goodbye. I didn't have time for guilt. I barely had time for myself. The meeting was all I could think about as I sped toward downtown. Amanda had reminded me twice to take a different route, warning about construction delays, but I'd brushed her off. Now, stuck at a red light, I could feel the minutes slipping away. "Of course," I muttered, glancing at the clock on the dashboard. When the light turned green, I pressed the gas, ready to barrel forward. That's when I saw it, a massive truck running its red light, barreling toward me at full speed. There was no time to react. One moment, I was gripping the steering wheel. The next, I was weightless. My car spun, the sound of metal crunching against metal filling my ears. Glass shattered, airbags deployed, and then silence. For a second, I thought I was still alive, waiting for pain to hit me like a tidal wave. But instead, there was nothing. No car, no truck, no sound of sirens. Just a strange, overwhelming stillness. I opened my eyes, or at least I thought I did, and found myself in a space that defied description. There were no walls, no ground, no sky. Just a vast expanse of shimmering light, threads of every color imaginable stretching infinitely in every direction. I could move, but I didn't feel trapped. Instead, I was drawn forward like something or someone was guiding me. The threads seemed to pulse with life, vibrating softly, and as I looked closer, I noticed they were woven together, forming intricate patterns that rippled and changed. Some areas were bright and beautiful, while others were dark and frayed, the edges unraveling. "What is this?" I whispered, though I wasn't sure I had a voice. A presence filled the space, neither male nor female, yet somehow warm and familiar. It didn't speak in words, but in understanding, as if pouring knowledge directly into my mind. "This is the loom room," it explained, "the tapestry of life." I didn't understand. I wanted to protest, to ask what this had to do with me, but the thread shifted, revealing a section of the tapestry that felt disturbingly familiar. The colors were muted, the patterns chaotic, as though someone had tried to force pieces together that didn't belong. My thread stood out, a single, jagged line cutting through the chaos. Frayed edges. Broken connections. It was ugly, disjointed, wrong. The presence guided me closer, and as I stared at the patterns, memories began to surface. I saw myself, younger and eager, working late nights to perfect my first collection. I remembered the pride I felt when my designs were praised, the thrill of signing my first big contract. But then the images changed. I saw Cheryl, sitting alone in a hospital waiting room while our mother lay dying. I saw Amanda crying in the office bathroom after I berated her for missing a deadline. I saw the homeless man on the corner I ignored every morning, his face growing more haggard with each passing day. The pain hit me like a physical blow. I had told myself these moments didn't matter, that my focus on my work excused my indifference to everything else. But now, seeing the threads unraveling because of my choices, I couldn't look away. "These are my mistakes," I whispered. "But I didn't know. I didn't think." "You chose not to see," the presence responded, its tone gentle but firm. "Every thread is connected. Every action, every word, weaves the fabric of existence. This is your contribution." I wanted to deny it, to insist that I couldn't be responsible for such damage. But the truth was undeniable. I had lived my life blind to the impact of my actions, chasing success while leaving a trail of frayed threads in my wake. The loom room began to shift, showing me more. This time, I saw the brighter threads, the rare moments when I'd acted out of kindness without realizing it. A young woman I'd encouraged during a tough critique now owned her own studio. A charity auction I donated to had funded a program that changed dozens of lives. The light from these threads was faint, overshadowed by the darkness, but it was there. It gave me hope, a glimmer of something better. "It is not too late to mend what has been broken," the presence said. "But your thread is fragile. It may not hold much longer." I felt the weight of those words, the reality sinking in. I didn't know what lay beyond this place, but I understood one thing. I wasn't ready to leave my thread in this state. I needed to make it right. I needed to try. The tapestry began to fade, the threads dissolving into light. Panic rose in me as I felt myself being pulled away. "Wait, I'm not done. I can fix it. I can." The world went dark again, and the sensation of my body returned, heavy, broken, and aching. Distant voices called my name, frantic and urgent, and I realized I was gasping for air. My eyes opened to flashing lights and the faces of paramedics leaning over me. I was alive, but the loom room and the truth it revealed would haunt me forever. I couldn't shake the vision of the loom room. Even as I lay in the hospital bed, hooked up to machines and surrounded by the sterile buzz of modern medicine, the image of the thread stayed vivid in my mind. Every flicker of light, every frayed edge, every missed connection haunted me. I kept telling myself it had to be a hallucination, the product of oxygen deprivation or a dying brain firing its last desperate neurons. And yet it felt more real than the beeping monitors and antiseptic smell around me. The nurses were kind but distant, their efficiency leaving little room for small talk. I didn't blame them. What would I even say? That I'd died, floated into some cosmic tapestry, and been confronted by the weight of my own failures? I barely understood it myself. Amanda stopped by once, looking pale and frazzled, though she didn't stay long. She left a bag of clothes and a card before rushing back to work, mumbling about catching up on deadlines. That hit me harder than I expected. I couldn't help wondering if I taught her to value her time so little, if she was mimicking the same cold dedication I'd always demanded for myself. Cheryl didn't visit at all. I tried not to dwell on it, but it stung more than I cared to admit. Maybe she didn't even know I was here. Or maybe she did and just didn't care. Either way, I couldn't blame her for that either. The doctors discharged me after a few days with a laundry list of follow-ups and physical therapy appointments. My body ached with every step, and my head swam with the weight of everything I'd seen or thought I'd seen. Back at home, the world felt strangely unfamiliar. The walls of my apartment, once a sanctuary of sleek design and perfect order, now felt cold and hollow. My neatly framed awards and fabric samples seemed to mock me, reminders of the life I'd built on selfish ambition. I spent the first night sitting on the edge of my bed, staring at the floor and replaying the loom room in my mind. The presence, the threads, the patterns, they weren't going away. No matter how hard I tried to rationalize it, the truth loomed over me. I'd been shown something extraordinary, and it demanded action. But what could I do? How could I possibly repair a life that felt so broken? The first thread I thought about was Cheryl. Our relationship had always been strained, even before Mom got sick. She'd called me selfish more times than I could count, and I dismissed her every time. But now, I couldn't ignore the memory of her sitting alone in that hospital waiting room. I hadn't been there. I'd convinced myself work was more important, that there'd be time to make it up later. But there hadn't been, had there? I picked up my phone and stared at her name in my contacts. My thumb hovered over the call button for what felt like an eternity. What would I even say? Sorry I wasn't there? Sorry I've been an awful sister? I wasn't sure I could handle hearing the anger in her voice, or worse, the indifference. My stomach churned as I pressed the button and held the phone to my ear. Ellie, her voice was surprised, guarded. Hi, I said, my throat tight. I just wanted to check in. See how you're doing. There was a pause, the kind that felt like it stretched for miles. I'm fine. Busy, but fine. Why? I had an accident. I blurted, my words tumbling over each other. A bad one. I was in the hospital. You what? Cheryl's voice sharpened. Why didn't anyone tell me? I didn't. I stopped, swallowing hard. I didn't think you'd want to know. There it was out in the open. The ugly truth I'd been avoiding. Cheryl let out a sharp breath, the kind that sounded more like frustration than concern. Ellie, for God's sake, you're my sister. Of course I'd want to know. I'm sorry, I whispered, my voice cracking. For everything, not just the accident. For not being there for Mom. For not being there for you. Another pause, this one softer. Ellie, what's going on? You're not dying, are you? The question hit me like a punch to the chest. No, I said quickly. At least, I don't think so. But I feel like I've been given a second chance, and I don't want to waste it. I don't want to waste us. Cheryl didn't respond right away, and I held my breath, waiting. Finally, she sighed. Okay, maybe we can talk. But it's going to take time, Ellie. Time is all I'm asking for, I said. Thank you. When the call ended, I felt a strange mix of relief and guilt. It was a start, but I knew it wasn't enough. Cheryl deserved more than a phone call. She deserved action. But first, there was someone else I needed to face. The next morning, I went to my closet and pulled out a few warm jackets I hadn't worn in years. I stuffed them into a bag along with some granola bars and bottled water, then drove downtown to the corner where I'd seen the homeless man every morning. My heart pounded as I parked and walked toward him. He was there, slumped on the sidewalk, his face lined with exhaustion and despair. Hi, I said awkwardly, holding out the bag. I thought you might need this. He looked up, his eyes wary. Why? Because I hesitated. How could I explain it? Because I should have helped sooner. He stared at me for a long moment before taking the bag. Thanks, he muttered, his voice rough. I wanted to say more, to explain how much his presence had affected me, but the words felt stuck in my throat. So instead, I sat down on the curb a few feet away. He glanced at me, confused. Mind if I stay for a bit? I asked. He shrugged, and we sat in silence. It wasn't much, but it felt like a step, a small thread I could begin to weave into something better. After sitting on that curb for what felt like hours, I finally stood up, stiff and uncertain. The man never asked for my name, and I didn't ask for his. We exchanged a nod before I walked back to my car. It felt like such a small gesture, just a bag of supplies, a quiet moment, but something in me shifted. I couldn't help but think of his thread in the loom room, frayed and thin, tangled with mine. Maybe I couldn't undo the damage, but I could start repairing it, one knot at a time. Driving back home, my mind wandered to Amanda. I'd barely seen her since the accident, though she'd been dutifully handling the business while I was recovering. Dutiful. That was the word I always used for her, wasn't it? Amanda was more than capable, but I'd never treated her as anything other than a tool, a means to an end. I remembered her anxious expression the last time we spoke, her hands gripping a notepad like it was a lifeline. How many times had I dismissed her concerns or shot down her ideas without a second thought? I pulled into the parking lot of my office without really meaning to. The familiar building loomed above me, its sleek glass facade reflecting the afternoon sun. For years, this place had been my temple, the altar where I sacrifice my time, my relationships, my humanity. Now, standing at the door, I felt like a stranger. I pushed it open and stepped inside, my heels clicking against the polished floor. Amanda was at her desk, typing furiously, her brow furrowed in concentration. She didn't notice me at first, and I took a moment to watch her. She looked tired, her usually neat hair slightly frizzed, dark circles under her eyes. Guilt twisted in my stomach. How many times had I made her stay late to finish a project? How many times had I brushed off her efforts with a curt, good work and nothing more? "Hey, Amanda," I said, my voice softer than I intended. She startled, her fingers freezing over the keyboard. "Ellie, I didn't expect you back so soon. Are you okay?" "I'm fine," I said, though the word felt hollow. "Well, not fine, exactly. I'm trying to be better." Amanda blinked, clearly confused. "Better? What do you mean?" I hesitated, unsure how much to share. Finally, I settled on honesty. "I had a wake-up call. The accident. It made me realize how much I've taken for granted. How much I've taken you for granted." Her eyes widened, and she sat back in her chair, folding her arms. "I don't know what to say to that." "You don't have to say anything," I said quickly. "Just let me say thank you for holding everything together while I was gone, for putting up with me when I wasn't exactly the easiest person to work for." Amanda let out a short laugh, though it wasn't unkind. "That's an understatement." I smiled, though it hurt a little. "You're right, and I'm sorry for that. You deserve more than what I've given you, Amanda. You're talented, and you care about this company in ways I never acknowledged. I want to change that." Her expression softened, though there was still a hint of wariness in her eyes. "Well, I appreciate you saying that, but words only go so far." "I know," I said, nodding. "That's why I want to make some changes around here. You shouldn't have to handle everything on your own. I'll start by lightening your workload and hiring another assistant. And I'd like you to take the lead on the Harris project. You've been pushing for more responsibility, and I think it's time I trusted you with it." Amanda stared at me, stunned. "You're serious?" "Completely," I said. "You've earned it." For a moment, I thought she might cry, but she quickly composed herself and nodded. "Thank you, Ellie. I won't let you down." "I know you won't," I said, and for the first time in a long time, I felt like I'd done something right. When I left the office, the sun was beginning to set, painting the sky in shades of orange and pink. I stood on the sidewalk for a moment, breathing in the crisp air and marveling at how different everything felt. It wasn't just the world that had changed, it was me. For years, I'd built walls around myself, convinced that success meant shutting everyone else out. But the Loom Room had shown me the truth. No threat exists in isolation. We're all part of the same tapestry, and every action, every choice, affects the whole. That night, I sat at my kitchen table with a notebook and a pen, something I hadn't done in years. I used to sketch constantly, my notebooks filled with ideas and designs. But over time, the joy of creation had been replaced by the pressure of deadlines and expectations. Now, as I stared at the blank page, I felt a strange sense of peace. This wasn't about work or impressing a client. This was for me. I began to draw the threads as I remembered them, vibrant and luminous, weaving in and out of each other in complex patterns. My hand moved almost unconsciously, the image taking shape before my eyes. There were bright threads, dull threads, tangled threads, and broken ones. It was chaotic but beautiful, imperfect but whole. And in the center, I drew a single frayed thread, a reminder of where I'd been and where I still needed to go. The next morning, I called Cheryl again. This time, I didn't just check in. I asked her to meet me for coffee. She hesitated but finally agreed, and as I hung up, I felt a flicker of hope. It was a small step, but it was a start. I didn't know where this journey would lead or how long it would take to mend the damage I'd done. But for the first time in my life, I felt like I was moving in the right direction. And that was enough. Cheryl looked exactly how I remembered her. Though her smile was thinner, her eyes harder than they'd been the last time we saw each other. We sat across from each other in the corner of a small cafe, a neutral meeting place we'd agreed upon after a halting phone conversation. She ordered chamomile tea, I got coffee, and we both spent a little too much time stirring our drinks, avoiding each other's eyes. It felt like walking into a room where the air had been sucked out, a tension so heavy I could hardly breathe. "So," Cheryl said finally, setting her mug down with a soft clink, "what made you decide to call me out of the blue? And don't just say the accident." I took a deep breath, my fingers curling around my coffee cup like it was a lifeline. "Because it wasn't just the accident. Not really. It's what happened after." Her brow furrowed. "After? You mean when you were in the hospital?" "No," I said quietly. "I mean after I died." Her expression froze, her lips parting slightly as she processed what I'd just said. "You died?" I nodded, my stomach twisting. "Technically, yes. For about 7 minutes," the doctor said. My heart stopped, and they brought me back. But during those 7 minutes, I wasn't just gone. I was somewhere else. Cheryl leaned back, crossing her arms. She didn't speak, but her expression was skeptical, guarded. It was the look of someone who wasn't sure whether to believe or dismiss what they were hearing. I couldn't blame her. If our positions were reversed, I'd probably react the same way. "I don't expect you to believe me," I said quickly. "But Cheryl, I saw something. It wasn't a dream or some random flashes of memory. It was real as sitting here with you now." She stayed silent, so I pressed on. "It was this place, like a loom, but infinite. Threads stretched everywhere, weaving in and out of these massive patterns. They were alive, glowing, and I saw my thread, my life, woven into the fabric." Cheryl's eyes softened slightly, though she still seemed cautious. "What does that even mean? Your thread? It means everything I've ever done. Every choice I've ever made was part of this tapestry," I said, my voice breaking. "And Cheryl, it wasn't pretty. My thread was frayed and broken, tangled with other threads I'd damaged. I saw what I've done to you, to Amanda, to so many people. And I saw how much I'd ignored." Her lips pressed into a thin line, and she shook her head slowly. "Ellie, I don't know if I can do this right now." "Please," I said, reaching out but stopping short of touching her hand. "I'm not asking you to forgive me right this second. I just need you to know how sorry I am. For Mom. For not being there when you needed me. For thinking my work was more important than my family." Her eyes glistened, and for a moment, I thought she might cry. But instead, she sighed and looked away. "You were always so busy, Ellie. Even when we were kids, it felt like you didn't have time for anything that didn't matter to you. Do you know how hard it was to watch Mom get sicker and sicker, knowing you wouldn't come?" "I know," I whispered. "And I hate myself for it." Cheryl rubbed her temples, her voice quieter now. "What do you want from me? Do you want me to just say it's okay? Because it's not. I've spent years trying to accept that you weren't going to change." "I don't want you to say it's okay," I said, shaking my head. "I don't even deserve that. I just want a chance to show you that I can change. That I want to change." She studied me for a long moment, her eyes searching mine. Finally, she nodded, though it was hesitant. "All right, Ellie. One step at a time." Relief washed over me, though it was tempered by the weight of her words. One step at a time. I could work with that. The next steps came slowly, sometimes painfully. I started volunteering at the homeless shelter downtown, not just to ease my conscience, but to make a difference in the lives of people like the man I'd ignored for so long. It was uncomfortable at first, stepping into a world I'd avoided for years, but it felt right. Every meal I served, every conversation I had, felt like a small stitch in the tapestry, mending what I'd torn. At work, I let Amanda take the lead on the Harris project, just as I'd promised. Watching her flourish was both humbling and exhilarating. She brought ideas to the table I never would have considered, and the client loved her vision. When she got her first standing ovation during the presentation, I felt a swell of pride that had nothing to do with me. But the hardest thread to repair was Cheryl's. We started having weekly coffee dates, and while the conversations were awkward at first, they gradually became easier. We talked about our childhood, about Mom, about the years we lost. Cheryl still had her walls up, and I didn't blame her. But every now and then, she let them down, and I'd catch a glimpse of a sister I used to know. One evening, after months of tentative rebuilding, I found myself back at my kitchen table, sketching the threads again. This time, I drew them differently. The frayed edges were still there, but the lines were smoother, more connected. It wasn't perfect, far from it, but it was progress. And that was enough. As I stared at the drawing, I thought of the loom room, of the voice that had guided me. Its presence still lingered in my mind, a constant reminder of the unseen forces shaping our lives. I didn't know if I'd ever see that place again, but I knew one thing for certain. The work wasn't done. My thread still had a long way to go. The first thing I noticed when I woke up that morning was the quiet, the hum of the fridge, the distant sound of cars outside. Everything felt muted, like the world was holding its breath. I sat up in bed and stared at the faint light streaming through the blinds, feeling the weight of something I couldn't name. It wasn't sadness, exactly, or fear. It was more like a question, lingering in the air, waiting for me to answer it. Cheryl and I had made progress. Amanda was thriving. The shelter had become a place of strange comfort for me, where I'd started to feel connected to people I'd once walked past without a second thought. By all accounts, things were getting better. But deep down, I knew there was more to do. Something bigger. The loom room hadn't just been about showing me the threads I'd frayed. It was a call to action, a challenge to repair not just my own thread, but the connections I'd neglected for so long. I got dressed and made a cup of coffee, staring at the sketch I'd left on the kitchen table the night before. The threads I'd drawn were better now, smoother, more vibrant, but they still felt incomplete. There was an empty space in the middle of the pattern, a gap I couldn't fill no matter how many times I tried. I didn't know what it meant, but it gnawed at me, a constant reminder that my work wasn't finished. I thought of Cheryl, of her guarded smile, and the way her voice softened when she talked about Mom. I thought of the man at the shelter, the one who always asked for extra bread rolls because he said they reminded him of his childhood. I thought of Amanda, who'd left me a note on my desk the day before. Thanks for believing in me. Each memory felt like a thread, connecting me to something larger than myself. The presence I'd felt in the loom room hadn't left me entirely. It was quieter now, more like a whisper than a voice, but it was still there. And that morning, as I stared at the empty space in my sketch, I felt it stirring again, nudging me towards something I couldn't quite see. It hit me suddenly, the church. Amanda had mentioned it once, months ago, in the offhand way people bring up things they know the other person won't care about. I dismissed it at the time, but now the thought of it lingered in my mind, growing stronger by the second. Maybe that was the missing piece. Maybe I needed to understand what faith meant, not just to Amanda, but to the countless others whose threads were woven into the tapestry. The idea made me nervous. Church wasn't something I'd ever been comfortable with. My parents had dragged us to services when we were kids, but I'd tuned out most of it, bored by the rituals and unconvinced by the sermons. As an adult, I'd avoided it entirely, preferring the certainty of my own beliefs, or lack thereof. But now, standing in my kitchen with the morning light spilling over my half-finished sketch, I realized I couldn't ignore it any longer. I texted Amanda and asked if I could join her at church that Sunday. Her response came quickly. Of course. I think you'll really enjoy it. The enthusiasm in her words made me smile, though it also made me a little uneasy. I wasn't sure what to expect, and the thought of walking into a room full of strangers made my chest tighten. But I knew I had to go. I owed it to myself and to the loom room to find out what was waiting for me there. Sunday morning came faster than I'd expected. I dressed in a simple blouse and slacks, unsure of the dress code, and drove to the small brick building Amanda had described. The parking lot was already filling up when I arrived, and I hesitated for a moment, gripping the steering wheel as I watched people stream inside. They looked happy, at ease, like they belonged here in a way I never could. "Get out of the car, Ellie," I muttered to myself. "You've faced worse than this." I stepped out and joined the flow of people heading toward the entrance. Amanda spotted me almost immediately and waved, her smile bright and welcoming. She came over and hugged me, something she'd never done before, and guided me to a seat near the back. The room was warm and filled with the sound of soft music, a piano playing as people settled into their seats. The service began with singing, something I hadn't done in years. Amanda handed me a hymnal, and I followed along as best I could, though my voice felt small and uncertain. The words on the page spoke of grace, forgiveness, and love, concepts that had always felt abstract to me. But as the music swelled and the voices around me grew stronger, I felt something stir in my chest, a flicker of warmth that surprised me. When the pastor took the stage, he spoke about the power of community and the importance of connection. He talked about how every person's life is part of a greater story woven together by the hands of God. The words hit me like a thunderclap, so close to what I'd seen in the loom room that I could barely breathe. It wasn't just coincidence. It couldn't be. This was what I'd been missing, the gap in my tapestry finally beginning to take shape. After the service, Amanda introduced me to a few people, their faces kind and welcoming. I felt out of place, but also strangely at home, like I'd stumbled into a room full of strangers who somehow already knew me. One woman, an older lady with bright eyes and a gentle smile, took my hand and said, "We're glad you're here, dear. You're exactly where you need to be." Her words stayed with me long after I left, echoing in my mind as I drove home. Exactly where I needed to be. For the first time in a long time, I felt like that might actually be true. That night, I sat down at my kitchen table again, staring at the sketch in front of me. Slowly, carefully, I picked up my pencil and began to fill in the empty space. The threads wove together easily now, the gaps closing as the pattern grew stronger, more complete. By the time I set the pencil down, I was smiling, a sense of peace settling over me. The work wasn't done, not by a long shot, but I was on the right path. And for the first time, I believed I could finish what I'd started. I stood in front of the church, the building feeling so different now, as if I were standing at the edge of something important. The sun had set, and the soft glow of the streetlights cast a warm halo around the entrance. I took a deep breath, feeling the familiar flutter of nervousness in my stomach, but this time it didn't feel quite as heavy. The fear I'd once had, the overwhelming anxiety about doing the wrong thing or saying the wrong words, was fading piece by piece, like threads unraveling from my mind. Today marked the first time I would volunteer at the shelter in a more meaningful way. No longer just showing up to serve meals or tidy up, but actually engaging with the people who came through those doors, trying to understand their lives instead of merely offering them a moment of charity. I wasn't sure where it would take me or how much I could actually do to make a difference, but I felt this deep need to try, to do more than just make myself feel better. It wasn't enough anymore to make small repairs to the damage I'd caused. I needed to build something lasting. I had always been so certain, so driven by the need to control everything around me. For the first time in my life, I was willing to step into the unknown, to embrace the discomfort that had always kept me at arm's length from deeper relationships. I wasn't sure who I was anymore, at least not the woman I'd once thought I was. But that wasn't necessarily a bad thing. I was finally giving myself permission to learn, to grow, and to allow myself the chance to be something different. When I walked into the shelter that evening, I was greeted with a familiar smile from the volunteer coordinator, Claire. She had always been kind, though our exchanges had been brief in the past. "Hey, Ellie," she said warmly. "Ready for tonight?" I nodded, taking in the room around me. The kitchen was buzzing with volunteers moving efficiently, cutting vegetables, stirring pots, and setting out trays of food. The main area was filling up with people, some sitting in groups at tables, others standing by the bulletin board, reading the daily announcements. There was a rhythm to it, a sense of purpose in the room, and it grounded me in a way I hadn't anticipated. "I'm ready," I said, my voice steady. "Just not really sure how I can help yet." Claire smiled knowingly. "Don't worry about that. Just talk to people. You'd be surprised how much that means to them." I wasn't sure how talking could possibly make any difference, but I figured it was a place to start. I grabbed a tray of sandwiches and walked over to a man sitting alone near the window. He was in his late 50s, his face weathered by years of hardship, and his hands were rough, the skin cracked and calloused. I hesitated for a moment, then sat down beside him. "Mind if I join you?" I asked, offering him a sandwich. He looked up, surprised at first, then nodded slowly. "Sure." For a few moments, we ate in silence, the only sound between us the soft murmur of voices around the room. I could feel his eyes on me, but I didn't rush to fill the silence with words. I simply let the moment stretch, giving him space to speak if he wanted. It was strange, this stillness, this pause. I had always filled silence with chatter, with busyness, with noise. But here, in the quiet, I felt something shift within me. Finally, he spoke. "You don't seem like the type to be here," he said, his voice gruff but not unfriendly. I shrugged. "I'm not sure what kind of person I am anymore." He chuckled softly, a sound full of tiredness. "You're not the only one. I think we're all still figuring it out, just in different ways." I wasn't sure what to say to that. The conversation felt strange, as though I were speaking to someone who saw the world in a way I could never fully understand. But instead of retreating into my comfort zone, I chose to stay present. "What's your name?" I asked. He hesitated, then offered a slight grin. "Danny. Nice to meet you, Danny. I'm Ellie." He nodded, the corners of his eyes crinkling as though he were smiling behind the exhaustion that was clearly etched into his face. "You come here often?" "I've been a few times," I admitted. "But this is the first time I've really talked to anyone." He raised an eyebrow. "Just here to do your good deed for the day?" I felt a sharp pang of guilt, knowing he wasn't far off the mark. I hadn't come for the right reasons before. I hadn't truly seen the people here. I had come because it made me feel better, to silence the nagging sense of inadequacy. But I didn't say that. Instead, I just nodded slowly. "I guess you could say that." Danny looked at me carefully, sizing me up, then shook his head. "You don't have to do this for me. But if you're here, I guess you might as well stay for the long haul." The weight of his words hung in the air, heavy and undeniable. It wasn't just about showing up, wasn't just about doing a good deed and moving on. It was about being present, being involved, and truly understanding the people who shared this moment in time with me. For the first time, I realized that these weren't just acts of charity I was engaging in. They were opportunities to weave threads, real, meaningful connections that would last longer than the fleeting moments of my busy, self-centered life. I spent the rest of the evening listening, not just to Danny, but to others who approached the table, who offered their own stories and shared their lives with me. There was the young mother struggling to make ends meet, the elderly man who'd been homeless for over a decade, who still held on to hope that things would improve, the teenager who'd run away from an abusive home and found sanctuary in this place. Each of them had a thread of their own, and with every conversation, I felt those threads intertwining with mine. I wasn't just repairing my own brokenness, I was becoming part of something much larger. When I finally left that night, my heart was fuller than it had been in years. The gap in my tapestry, the one I'd struggled to fill, was slowly closing. It wasn't about fixing everything in a single moment or mending the past with a few simple gestures. It was about being open, being willing to step outside of myself and allow my thread to connect to others. I didn't have all the answers, but I was learning piece by piece how to weave a new story. And somehow I knew that the work wasn't done yet. But it wasn't something I had to rush. For the first time, I understood that I was exactly where I needed to be.